characters football team has been one to genuinely like each other. They've had a great attitude. They're very loyal and very hardworking. This group has worked as hard as any group we've had.
Down, Penn State.
Tailgating festivities arrived early for Penn State fans as the Lions appeared in the 9th annual kickoff classic. It was the end of August, and these fans showed preseason confidence.
We're number one.
A kickoff classic record crowd filled Giants Stadium to watch the blue and white tackle defending national champion Georgia Tech. With 13 starters returning, the Lions were ready to roar in front of a national television audience. To the delight of their fans and the surprise of their opponent, Penn State came out throwing. Tony Sackett to Terry Smith, the start of something big.
Sackett straight back to pass, looping one in the end zone for Terry Smith. He's got it for the touchdown.
When you turn a guy's hips, you can tell whether you have him beat or not. And he turned his hips quite a bit. And once I came out of my brick, I left him standing still. You're in the end zone, so you're getting six for the team, and it's a wonderful feeling.
Penn State's defense shared that feeling as they refused to be impressed by Georgia Tech's 16-game win streak. This Matt Baggett theft set the stage for the most exciting catch of the 1991 season.
Here is Sackett play action, going to go deep right away for O.J. McDuffie. McDuffie leaps, has it, and can he hold on? Yes, touchdown, Penn State, a juggling catch in the end zone by O.J. McDuffie.
Tony put the ball up perfectly, and I went up to get it. And while I was up there, I kind of lost it. You know, I kind of started to bobble, and I was getting mad at myself while I was up there. I just did everything in my power just to keep my eye on the ball and try to refocus and gather it in. And I watched it all the way. I saw it on my shoulder, and I saw it falling down. And I put my hand under, placed it in my hand perfectly, and made the catch, basically.
After sitting out 1990 with a knee injury, O.J. McDuffie had returned better than ever. Linebacker Rich McKenzie also bedeviled the rambling wreck as he single-handedly regained possession for Penn State and set up Tony Sacka's school record fifth touchdown pass of the game.
And here comes the screen to Richard Anderson. He's got some room at the 45, the 40, 35, 30. Cuts back at the 25. Anderson to the 20, to the 15, the 10. Cuts back again, gets by Swilling and goes in for the touchdown.
Winning the 1991 kickoff classic, Penn State had opened the season in spectacular style.
We really needed to come out strong, you know, in the opener. And Georgia Tech was a pretty high-ranked team in the beginning, so we knew if we could, you know, beat them, you know, we could have a great season. And we came out and we played really well, and everything worked out for us.
A new expanded north end zone at Beaver Stadium greeted Penn State fans in their home opener with Cincinnati. With the new addition, the stadium would now seat 93,716, making it the second largest on-campus stadium in college football. And what an offensive explosion this record crowd witnessed. Against the Bearcats, Penn State scored on 12 of its first 15 tries, rolled up more than 700 yards of total offense, turned the headlines over to many of the younger players, and scored 81 points, the most ever by a Joe Paterno coach team. Before the final gun sounded, there wasn't a single Penn Stater in uniform who hadn't played. A soaring score and an expanded Beaver Stadium made it a memorable day in University Park. The Lions took their 2-0 record and an 11-game regular season winning streak to the West Coast, where they ran into a Southern California team hungry to upset the number 5 ranked blue and white. Joe Paterno gave credit to USC for winning a tough, aggressive game, but also added prophetically, "We'll be a good football team. We have to stick together. We can be a great team." Recapturing the momentum to become a great team would begin 1 week later back in University Park. An ABC television audience and more than 96,000 fans focused on Beaver Stadium to watch Penn State defense college football's all-time leading passer, Brigham Young's Ty Detmer.
Hi, the last time we played them, he threw the ball for about 500 yards, and we knew what he was capable of doing. But number one, we were talking about stopping the run, and that's the way we approach every game. And BYU was talking about running the ball a little bit, and as soon as we stopped the run on them, then we could start blitzing some people and bringing people and playing a little man to man, and everything worked out well.
And we knew that they were going to throw the ball, so that's half the battle. Knowing what's happening to you, so we put the pressure on Detmer, and we come out on top.
It didn't seem to matter how much he called for help. Detmer dialed nothing but wrong numbers. With a lion in his face on every snap, the BYU senior was sacked 6 times and held to career lows in completions and yardage. Ioka Jackson, Lou Benfatti, Mark D'Onofrio, Eric Rabatti were among the blue defenders limiting BYU to just 7 points, its lowest total in 57 games. As so often in their proud tradition, Penn State had totally shut down a Heisman Trophy winner. The offense also sparkled in this total team victory. When Derek Bonna picked off a Detmer aerial early in the game, Tony and Terry took the turnover to a touchdown.
Well, as we came up to the line, we were kind of pressed for time because the play clock was running down, and Tony quickly audibled the call off, and I ran a little corner route again, and Tony put it right where it had to be, and I made the diving catch.
As Joe Paterno plotted to keep Detmer off the field, he turned control of the game over to a punishing ground attack. Jerry Collins scored once and Richie Anderson twice, as Penn State held the ball nearly 24 minutes longer than Brigham Young. A 33-7 triumph over BYU put Penn State back on the right track and returned the Lions to the top 10. Against Boston College, the Penn State Air Force came out flying high.
He takes a short drop, wants to throw. Nobody open. Now throws to the sideline, completes it to O.J. McDuffie. McDuffie gets away, and he's going down the sideline. He's at the 25, the 20. Cuts back to the 15 and down to the 12-yard line. Tony Sacka back to pass. Here's the screen. That inside screen to Terry Smith. He's to the 35, the 30. Still going to the 25, the 20. Terry Smith is in for the touchdown. Takes the snap, takes a short drop, he's looking. Fires deep down the sideline for Troy Drayton. Drayton makes the catch at the 5-yard line. He's down there. Sacka rolls out to the left side. He's looking under pressure. Scrambles back to the right side. Here goes Tony. He's going to tuck it down and go for the end zone. He's in for the touchdown.
The Lions' offense roared while the Eagles were grounded. One of 3 interceptions by Lions hero back Darren Perry set up a 56-yard romp by Boston College's worst nightmare, Shelly Hammonds. In the past 2 years against the Eagles, the sophomore from Barnwell, South Carolina, has run for an incredible 298 yards. On defense, Reggie Givens and Leonard Humphreys added interceptions. But this would be a career day for senior Darren Perry. Penn State won its 13th in a row over an Eastern rival. Continuing with Eastern competition, Penn State traveled to the birthplace of our nation, Philadelphia and Veterans Stadium, to meet the Temple Owls. Playing in spite of a painful shoulder, senior Mark D'Onofrio, number 38, again proved to be the emotional leader of this carnivorous defense. He fueled the fires of a Penn State team that marched to its 26th consecutive victory over the Temple Owls. When Darren Perry tied a Penn State record with his third career interception return for a touchdown, the Lions clinched victory number 5 in this exciting 1991 season. But an extremely difficult road trip to Miami lay straight ahead. The Orange Bowl was jammed to capacity. The Orange Bowl was loud. And the Orange Bowl was sweltering. Into this hot and hostile surrounding stepped Joe Paterno's Lions to play the number 2 ranked team in college football. And play them they did. Penn State had more first downs than Miami, completed more passes for more yards than Miami, and held the football nearly twice as long as Miami. But the Lions' leading tackler, Mark D'Onofrio, was ailing with a shoulder injury that would put him out for the remainder of the season. The Lions battled the Heat and the Hurricanes on even terms and fell just 6 points short. It was time for senior leadership to step forward and keep this team focused on its mission.
We got together, the captains had gotten together and just said, look, you know, we have to keep, make sure we keep the team up because we can win the rest of our games regardless of who we're playing.
On homecoming 1991, Rutgers would become the first hurdle in Penn State's drive to win that final five. Kyle Brady's catch and bull-like run, followed by a Sam Gash touchdown, revealed the resolve of this squad. Offense, defense, and special team play all combined to make this a homecoming to celebrate.
High fluttering kick goes to McDuffie at the Penn State 45, starts the return at the 50. He's to the 45, the 40. McDuffie's at the 35, 30. He's going to go all the way. O.J. McDuffie takes it for a touchdown.
The 55-yard punt return was just part of McDuffie's brilliant afternoon. The dynamic duo of McDuffie and Terry Smith entered the Lion record book, catching more passes in a season than any two teammates in Penn State history. The golden arm of Joe Paterno's record-setting passing attack, Tony Sacca, threw for more than 200 yards and ran for nearly 50. The Lions scored 37 points while the defense limited Rutgers to 44 yards on the ground. Interceptions by Lee Rubin and Mark Graham clinched the victory, and gave Joe Paterno his 235th career triumph, making him the fifth winningest coach in college football history. Game day at University Park is an autumn spectacle. Downtown State College fills with Nittany Lion fans seeking mementos of their favorite team. They share in the tradition of success that has steered this program to a pair of national championships and 17 top 10 rankings in the past three decades. They come from across the state and across the nation to be a part of the excitement and enjoyment that is Penn State football.
Fly on state, strike your gate and win. Victory we predict for thee, we're ever true to you, dear old white and blue. Onward state, roar Lions, roar. We'll hit that line, roll up the score, fight on to victory evermore. Fly.
Another record crowd of more than 96,000 roared a welcome to the eighth-ranked Lions. And Penn State responded with a successful 80-yard drive on their first possession against West Virginia.
Zaka is back to pass. He's looking. Throws over the middle, wide open Grady, and he's got it for the touchdown. Touchdown, Penn State.
The Lions were hot, and West Virginia seemed overmatched against this active and aggressive defense. Shelly Hammonds led the Lions to one score, a dive by Saka. And Richie Anderson followed the vastly improved offensive line of Todd Berger, John Jarek, Craig Huntington, Frank Gallagher, and Paul Seaver to the end zone.
That game was when the offensive line started to really gel together. And my success in that game was due to the offensive line and also Sam Gash, who was just an excellent fullback for me.
As Anderson followed Sam Gash in his maturing offensive line, the Lions added more balance to their attack. This opened the aerial lanes for Tony Saka to find his team's high-powered jet, Otis James McDuffie.
First and 10, starting off the fourth quarter. Saka is back to pass, throws to the sideline. Complete to McDuffie at the 10, the 5. Touchdown, Penn State. First and 10, Saka on first down, rolling right, looking to pass. Has some protection in front of him. Can't find anybody open, though. Now throws back across the field, and it is caught by McDuffie at the 5. Loops around and goes in for the touchdown.
This multi-strike offense scored 51 points and held the ball nearly 20 minutes longer than West Virginia. The visitors simply couldn't avoid their 19th straight defeat at Beaver Stadium. In front of a national ESPN audience, the Lions emphasized the strength of their drive toward the top of the national poll. November came, crisp and challenging, and the Lions visited Maryland at Memorial Stadium in Baltimore. For the fifth time this season, Penn State turned its opening drive into 6 points. Following a touchdown run by Maryland native Richie Anderson, the Lions defense stuffed the Terrapins. A roadblock tackle by Keith Goganis. A stinging hit by Lee Rubin. A lunging body press by Rich McKenzie. A shoestring sack by Rudy Glocker. And a leaping theft by Rubin. All showcasing the nonstop dominance of the Lion defenders. Tony Saka entered the record book as Penn State's all-time leader in career passing yards and completions. Whether throwing to tight end Kyle Brady of Camp Hill or Terry Smith of Monroeville, Saka had a variety of potent weapons in his arsenal. the running of Richie Anderson, and Maryland couldn't diagnose the versatility of the Lions' offense.
There's a high short kick by DeArmas. McDuffie takes it at the 40-yard line, starts the return to the right, gets through the first line of men. He's at the 50, 45, at the 40. OJ is going to take it in. He's at the 25, the 20, the 10, 5. Touchdown, Penn State. Gary Collins takes the snap, four-man rush by the Terps. Looking to pass, now here comes a screen pass to JT Morris. JT is at the 40, the 45, the 50. He's at the 45. The Express is off and running again. JT Morris goes in for the touchdown.
Now 8-2, the Lions return home for a national television encounter with Notre Dame. Penn State and the Fighting Irish. A nation watching. And the final home appearance for 19 Nittany Lions seniors.
This was the last time that we were going to play in Beaver Stadium, and we wanted to just have the whole place going. I mean, everybody up on their feet, you know, national TV audience. We just wanted to go out there and just show everybody that Notre Dame can't come in Penn State territory and, you know, win.
Yes, this is Penn State territory.
Fires over the middle. It is caught down at the 22-yard line. Kyle Brady with a reception. He throws. This one complete to McDuffie. He's down to the 5 and 3-yard line. The handoff to Anderson. Off tackle right. He dives. He's in for the touchdown. Richard Anderson, a 3-yard touchdown run. Penn State with a thing of beauty to start it off. And they're up 6-0.
Beaver Stadium rocked as Penn State jumped right back on the Irish, mixing their plays brilliantly, and thundered downfield once again. In just 12 minutes, the Lions had punctured Notre Dame's defense for drives of 73, 73, and 53 yards, and had 21 points. Now it was up to Penn State's defenders to dig in against the run-oriented Irish.
Our plan to stop them was basically that we had to stop the run. We knew we could control the running game of Notre Dame and make them put the ball up in the air. It would kind of balance out in our favor.
We put a couple defenses in that week, you know, to help, you know, clog up the middle, you know, bring the linebackers inside and stop it, you know, their fullback pounding the middle. You know, we got them out of their game plan and going into passing attack.
Fight was drained from the Irish as Lions like Jim Dieter and Brett Wright helped keep Notre Dame's ground game under 100 yards. Penn State's command of the Irish attack was never more evident than late in the first half, when Notre Dame could not score after several tries from the Lions' 2-yard line. Then the defense set up even more points.
Second down and long, and Meyer takes the snap. Play action, looking to throw. Fires over the middle. This one is intercepted by Lou Benfatti at the 37-yard line. Benfatti goes down. Hold on, first and 10. Sacka hands off to Gash. Here comes the reverse to O.J. McDuffie. O.J. has a lane, gets a block from Sacka. He's at the 25, the 20, 15, 10, 5. Touchdown, Penn State.
But we want to capitalize big. We usually go with a big play after, you know, a turnover like that, and we went with the reverse off a handoff from Sam, and Tony threw the great kickout block. And I mean, it was just a perfect play call, and everybody executed perfectly. You know, Terry pinned his man in real well, and it's basically cakewalking to the end zone following Todd Berger.
Penn State's flying wideout teamed with the school's all-time leading passer for one more spectacular score, as the Lions defeated Notre Dame for the 8th time in their past 11 meetings, in the final home game for the Lions seniors.
When I came off that field with the realization that that was it, I was never going to be on that field again as a player, it kind of hits you hard. It's like a punctuation mark at the end of your time here.
And just to look in the locker room after the game, look around at, you know, at the Gashes and the Perrys and the D'Onofrios and Gogainis and everybody, and just say, this is the last time this group is going to be together. It's a very emotional moment. And that, you know, it's one that you want to remember, though, for the rest of your life at the same time.
Penn Penn State and Pittsburgh have wrestled each other 90 times in one of the longest-lasting rivalries in college football. On Thanksgiving Day, in front of national TV for the seventh time this season, the Lions repeated the early wake-up call that had characterized their play all season. A tight end screen to Troy Drayton gave the Fiesta Bowl-bound Lions an advantage over Pitt they would never surrender. As they had against Notre Dame, the blue and white erupted again on their second drive. Just 5.5 minutes into the battle, Richie Anderson put the unyielding Lions up 14-0. When Pitt had the ball, Joe Paterno relied on his white-shirted fortress of tacklers, who ranked in the top 10 in just about every major defensive category. As the Panthers tried to crowd the skies, it was Penn State's pass defense that shot them down with 5 interceptions. The turnovers led to 4 field goals by Craig Fayak, who grew up minutes from Pitt Stadium in Bell Vernon. Fayak's 12 points and Doug Helkowski's punting proved vital. But the struggle wasn't secure until the defense again set up the offense.
Back to pass is Van Pelt. He's looking. Now throws over the middle. This one is intercepted. Picked off by Darren Perry. He's at the 30 and down to the 29. A tie formation in the backfield, and they hand it off to Richard Anderson straight up the middle. He's at the 30, 25, 20, 15, 10, 5. Richard Anderson, touchdown.
It was in the clutch, you know. We needed that touchdown to secure the game, and I was just, you know, delighted.
I was drive blocking, and next thing I know, I saw a flash come past me, you know, out of the corner of my eye, and I saw him streaking down towards the end zone, we could tell that we were on top and we were going to stay there.
Anderson's second touchdown ensured a coveted 10-victory season for Penn State, their 14th under Joe Paterno. They had come back from Miami to win their final 5. And savored the accomplishment and success of a triumphant season.
Once you start winning games, you have a feeling that you can't lose. And that's what, you know, that's in a sense what helps you win. We wanted to go out like champions, and we did.
Led by an extraordinary group of talented seniors, this 1991 Penn State squad finished the regular season among the top 6 teams in college football. Senior Tony Sacca rewrote the Lion passing records, and senior Terry Smith moved to the top as Penn State's leading receiver. Senior leadership carried this team through a 10-win season and into the Fiesta Bowl on New Year's Day. They were a special group that represented their university with poise and determination, and turned 1991 into a season of pride and accomplishment. Over the years, Penn State had played in the Fiesta Bowl 4 times and won them all. The Nittany Lions' 5th visit to the site of their 1986 National Championship game paired the Eastern Champions against the explosive Tennessee Volunteers of the Southeastern Conference. As
As they arrived in Phoenix, the sixth-ranked Lions believed they were the equal of any team in college football. What followed was a game that would verify that opinion and stagger the imagination. Fiesta Bowl 21 would be a tempest in Tempe.
The Fiesta Bowl is a tremendous place to take a team. Everybody, we knew everybody would have a good time, and we were glad that we were going to be able to play Tennessee. So we just sat back and said, hey, look, let's forget about the fact that we're not going to be able to play somebody that's ranked higher than we are, but we're going to play a fine football team, we're going to go to a good place, going to have a good time, and let's see if we can prove to the country that maybe Penn State's as good a football team as there is anywhere right now.
Let's go State!
Penn State rode a five-game winning streak into the Fiesta Bowl. They brought a defense ranked in the nation's top 10 and the most prolific passing offense in Penn State history. University President Dr. Joab Thomas, Athletic Director Jim Tarman, and their wives joined thousands of blue and white fans who celebrated the new year enjoying the Arizona sunshine. They let everyone know they were Penn State proud. The Lions' focus could not be diverted from the task at hand, facing a powerful Tennessee football team. A demanding practice regimen addressed the Lions' physical preparations. An exuberant pep rally at the team's Scottsdale Hotel elevated the Lions' emotional pitch. 10,000 Penn State fans had converged on Phoenix, bringing a piece of Happy Valley to the Valley of the Sun. These 1991 Nittany Lions were just one victory away from a season that would stand as one of the finest in the 106-year history of Penn State football.
Looks like you guys have been enjoying yourselves just as much as we have, but we know this trip wouldn't be complete without a victory come Wednesday, so we're going to go out there and play our best and bring home a victory to Penn State.
The guys that sit behind me have really put in some long hours this year, including the coaching staff. And it would be a shame for us not to go out and play our hardest for this last game of this year and the last game that we're going to play in the blue and white. So thank you.
We want to go out on Wednesday, and we want everybody at today turn that tube off to say, hey,
we're number one.
Penn State may be the best football team in the country. But deep down in our hearts, I want them to feel and say to them, we are number one.
Game programs.
The fans caught Paterno's enthusiasm as they invaded Sun Devil Stadium from across Pennsylvania and across the United States.
Laguna Hills, but originally from McKeesport, Pennsylvania.
Lancaster, Pennsylvania.
California.
Allentown.
Rock Haven.
Philadelphia.
Altoona, Pennsylvania.
Belfont, Pennsylvania.
Dallas.
Go Lions!
On the sun-kissed first day of 1992, Penn Staters hoped to climax their holiday with a waltz past Tennessee. A capacity crowd of more than 71,000 and an NBC television audience wondered who would be the first to blink in this battle of heavyweight offenses. Following the pregame spectacular, Lions fans settled in for what they hoped would be a typical Penn State Fiesta Bowl performance. They knew Joe Paterno's 22nd bowl team, led by an extraordinary group of seniors, would not take a back seat to any other college squad in the country. A preview of the wild swings of momentum this game would produce was provided on the opening kickoff. No team in college football had a better turnover margin than Penn State during the regular season. Their opportunism continued as number 41, Jeff Kerwin, a sophomore from Kearney, New Jersey, claimed possession for Penn State at point-blank range. A delayed pass over the middle to fullback Sam Gash handed the blue and white a lead less than 90 seconds into the game.
There was basically a little delay to me and everything coming out of the backfield. I had to wait for the tailback to clear, you know, clear the linebackers out of field, and then, you know, I would just pop right out, right over the tackle and just catch the ball. But I think I had to maybe make one person miss me, and then I just, you know, sort of just high-stepped on into the end zone. But I had never scored a touchdown in a bowl game, and that was my first and probably most exciting touchdown.
Gash's quick touchdown marked the eighth game this season the Lions had scored on their very first possession. But the Vols came right back, added a touchdown, and kicked a field goal to take a three-point lead. Throughout an otherwise scoreless first half, the long-distance punting of Doug Helkowski continually pinned Tennessee deep in its own territory. As the first 30 minutes wound to a conclusion, the defense and specialty teams vetoed any Tennessee ambitions of adding to its advantage. Penn State forced a field goal miss and otherwise frustrated the Volunteers' offense. The Lions stepped up their pressure, contained Tennessee in the scoring zone, kept it close, and closed out the quarter with a crucial fourth down stand that provided some momentum heading into halftime, with the Vols clinging to a three-point lead.
Well, halftime, I really was not that concerned because we were only down 10-7, and we really should have been down 17-0, maybe as much as 24-0. Tennessee played as well as they had the first half, and you're only down by 3 points. You really got to just go in and feel pretty good about it. And I told the squad, I said, look, we hustle, make a couple plays, we can win this game easily. We've been here before, been down before.
Penn State fans shared Paterno's confidence. How many times have the Nittany Lions taken command of games after a tight first half? But even in their wildest imagination, the faithful could not forecast the bizarre occurrences that would unfold after intermission. In the third quarter, Penn State's problems multiplied as Tennessee increased its lead to 17-7. Apprehension that the game could be slipping away was becoming more difficult to dismiss. Penn State's multidimensional offense continued to struggle. The defense was keeping them in the game. As linebacker Reggie Gibbons refused to be fooled on a Tennessee run out of punt formation, the Lions knew they needed a spark that would turn this game around. On State's next defensive series, they again smothered Tennessee and again forced them to give up the football. Finally, the stage was set for O.J. McDuffie to ignite a wild and unpredictable explosion.
O.J. McDuffie awaiting the kick, a low driving spiral. McDuffie takes it to 26, dances away from the tackler, across the 30, 35, cuts back at the 40, 45, 50, 45, 40, down the left sideline to the 30, driven out of bounds. Great run back by O.J. McDuffie.
It was a lazy punt up in the air, and I caught it with room. You know, I had a couple defenders in front of me. Made one guy miss, and Jeff Kerwin knocked another one out. And basically, it was just a matter of reading some blocks and getting upfield.
We were so frustrated. We were fighting to get some kind of control over the game. So when O.J. broke the punt return, that gave us an opportunity to get back in it and get back in a hurry.
Striking through the air, the Lions used a Tony Sacca to McDuffie pass to get close. And then chipped into the Tennessee advantage with a Sacca pass to Chip LaBarca, the first scoring reception ever for the junior wideout from Bayville, New Jersey. The Lions were revived after closing the margin to 17-14. With less than 3 minutes to play in the third period, the defense still had plenty of fire in its belly as Tioka Jackson bolted through the Tennessee protection and single-handedly took the ball away from the ball. It was another staggering uppercut for the suddenly beleaguered Volunteers.
First down at the 14, Tony Sacco rolling to his right, looking to throw, back across the grain, complete to the tight end, Kyle Brady.
In what seemed like an instant, Brady had stepped inside the pylon for the touchdown that put Penn State in charge 21-17. A second look shows that Brady cleverly got lost in traffic at the line of scrimmage. While everyone else rolled right, Brady found himself alone on the left. In the span of less than a minute, Penn State had changed the entire complexion of Fiesta Bowl 21. And the Lions were just warming to the task.
Kelly with a play action fake to Phillips, rolling left, fires on the run, and it's intercepted. Picked off by Reggie Gibbons of Penn State.
First reaction, that's to get my hands on it. And I got my left hand on it, and it stopped, then it like hit my helmet. As long as I kept concentrating on the ball, and I knew I'd get it in after a while, so I kept running with it.
Penn State leads 21-17. They take over at the 26 of Tennessee. Tony Sacco back to throw, guns it over the middle. The pass is complete to Troy Drayton, the tight end, and he busts down inside the 10. So it'll be fourth and goal at the 1. The backs out of the eye. Anderson leaps into the end zone. Touchdown.
Penn State's lead was now 11 in this fast-developing tempest in Tempe.
My thoughts when it was happening really didn't have much to think about. I just was trying to stay on top of the pace. It was just a question of trying not to let the thing get out of hand, where maybe we would have gotten careless in some play selection. And once we got it under control, I wanted to make sure that we didn't let it get away from us.
We couldn't really believe the turnaround that was happening at that particular time, but we just didn't want to even question it. It was almost like we were just in sync with each other.
Kelly with a short drop, looking to throw, gets hammered! Oh, he got smoked, the ball is loose, and being run into the end zone by Reggie Gibbons.
Gibbons' big play had been created by a blitzing Derek Bonna, number 35, a sophomore from tiny Mapletown High School in western Pennsylvania. There was no stopping Penn State now, as Gibbons rumbled in with his first collegiate score. The Lions had singed Tennessee with 4 touchdowns in less than 5 minutes. As night fell on Tempe, one more Thunderbolt dropped on Tennessee. The dynamic passing combo of Sacco to McDuffie closed out the wildest 8 minutes in Penn State Bowl history. Record-setting receiver Terry Smith, number 8, sat out the game with an injury, but shared in McDuffie's delight. 10 minutes remained, but the lights had long been extinguished for the shocked Volunteers. The Lions had played a turnover-free game. They blended a strong performance from their defense, special teams, and offense to score the most points ever surrendered by Tennessee in a bowl game. They had added a chapter to their bowl biography, sure to be among the most discussed in Lion football history. As blue and white fans celebrated a 42-17 victory, linebacker Reggie Gibbons gained Defensive Player of the Game honors, and wideout O.J. McDuffie was the voter's choice as the top offensive player. Joe Paterno claimed Penn State's 5th Fiesta Bowl trophy for a victory that turned on less than 8 implausible minutes, a time span that will be forever burned in the memories of Penn State fans everywhere. Following the Fiesta Bowl triumph, all the major polls rated the Lions number 3 in the country, making them the 10th Paterno coach team to finish in the top 5. More than a million fans witnessed Penn State's march to an 11-2 record. The formula has become familiar. An offense that makes the most of its weapons. Outstanding and opportunistic defense. Solid and productive kicking and special teams play. And the innate ability to respond to a challenge.
The way we finished is just incredible. You know, we had high hopes at the beginning of the season, high expectations, and you know, basically at the end, we played really strong and we came out third. You know, that's the best position I think we could have got considering how Washington and Miami played.
I'm very proud of this football team, very proud of them, because I think they hung in there and as I said, at the end of the year, I thought they were playing about as well as anybody.
The Nittany Lions of 1991 epitomized what Penn State pride is all about.